The story you're about to see is a big fat lie. No names have been changed to protect anybody.
Let's get ready to rumble!
Greetings, cartoon and football fans. This is Robbie Graham of the USCFL Network bringing you the action and highlights of an exciting Week 9 and the start of Round 3 of the USCFL's 2022 season. Now the real fun begins. From here on out, one team will be eliminated until two teams remain and will play in Disney Bowl 5 on July 23rd. Also starting now, the winning teams will no longer be guaranteed home field advantage. Both games this week were exciting indeed. Both teams that lost didn't deserve to be eliminated, for they gave it their all. But as in any other sports league, it becomes a question of who wants it more. Before we continue, we hope you'll want more of the USCFL. You can get it by subscribing to this channel and join our team. We strive to be one of YouTube's least offensive channels, providing a different spin about your favorite cartoon characters from the past and present. If your favorite character or characters aren't mentioned in these post-game shows, they are on one of the 16 teams, but in a second or third string capacity. If that is the case, please leave us a comment and we'll answer your questions. Also, be sure to ring the bell to alert you of any new video we put up. After a brief pause, we will talk about and present the highlights of an exciting Game 17 overtime thriller between the Warner Brothers All-Stars and the Marvel Comics All-Stars from Chicago. Welcome back. As we start round three, we'll also mention how each team has done so far. In addition, it no longer matters if a team is undefeated or winless. Anytime the teams face each other in Game 17, they know that if they lose, they'll finish dead last. Before Friday's game took place, the Warner Brothers All-Stars lost both of their games by only scoring a combined total of 16 points, only scoring one touchdown, but on defense. For the Marvel Comics All-Stars, they won in Game 11 against the Sci-Fi All-Stars by scoring the first 60-point game in 3 years. They also had scored a combined 98 points, but none of that mattered. At legendary Soldier Field in Chicago, the home of the NFL's Chicago Bears, that has seen many a memorable game, can add Friday's game to that roster. In the first quarter, Warner Brothers' offensive unit redeemed themselves as Bugs Bunny threw a 45-yard touchdown pass to the Roadrunner. A Wile E. Coyote field goal gave Warner Brothers a 10-0 lead after the first quarter. Another Wile E. field goal gave Warner Brothers a 13-0 lead with just over 3 minutes left in the first half. Marvel Comics didn't let Warner Brothers shut them out at halftime as Spider-Woman kicked a 47-yard field goal that took a lucky bounce off of the right upright and trailed 13-3 at halftime. Just as the third quarter began, Bugs Bunny connected with Marvin the Martian from 76 yards out to go up 20-3. About 3 minutes later, Marvel Comics began to bounce back as She-Hulk threw a 52-yard touchdown pass to the Amazing Spider-Man to trail 20-10. Bugs Bunny was hot in this game as he threw his third touchdown pass to Hampton J. Pig from Tiny Toon Adventures to go up 27-10 at the end of the third quarter. In the fourth quarter, Marvel Comics got back into the game as She-Hulk found Jubilee of the X-Men to trail 27-17 with just under 14 minutes left to play. Bugs Bunny threw his fourth touchdown pass to Daffy Duck to go up 34-17 with just over 11 minutes left to play. Marvel Comics made an amazing comeback as She-Hulk found Spider-Man again from 58 yards out to trail 34-24 with 9.5 minutes left. Spider-Woman's second field goal cut the lead 34-27 with 4.5 minutes left. Then with 32 seconds left, She-Hulk found Miss Marvel, and with a good booth replay, the game was tied at 34 and was sent into overtime. In the overtime period, Marvel Comics failed to get a score, then it was Warner Brothers' turn. Then with 11:45 left in the overtime period, Wally's third field goal gave Warner Brothers a 37-34 win and will move on to the quarterfinals. For Marvel Comics, they are eliminated from the tournament and finishes dead last for 2022. As for the stats in this game, beginning with Warner Brothers, Bugs Bunny, who was the player of the game, finished 22 of 34 for 372 yards and 4 touchdowns. He also rushed for 68 yards on 6 carries. Daffy Duck rushed for 130 yards on 31 carries. The Roadrunner led the receivers with 6 catches for 115 yards and 1 touchdown. Dot Warner of Animaniacs led the defense with 8 tackles and 7 assists. Wile E. Coyote finished with 13 points. For Marvel Comics, She-Hulk finished 38 of 59 for 511 yards and 4 touchdowns. Wolverine, who hasn't seen much action this season, only rushed for 9 yards on 12 carries. Sue Richards, a.k.a. the Invisible Woman from the Fantastic Four, rushed for only 44 yards on 19 carries. Spider-Man led the receivers with 5 catches for 153 yards and 2 touchdowns. Daredevil led the defense with 7 tackles, 9 assists, and 1 sack. Spider-Woman finished with 10 points. And here is how the highlights of this incredible performance looked on screen.
Thank you. close at hand. Creatures crawl in search of blood to terrorize your neighborhood. And whosoever shall be found without the soul for getting down must stand and face the hounds of hell and rot inside a corpse's shell. Stenches in the air, the funk of 40,000 years, and grisly ghouls from every tomb are closing in to seal your doom. And though you fight to stay alive, your body starts to shiver, for no mere mortal can resist the evil of the thriller.
Believe me when I tell you that neither team deserved to finish dead last, but again, that's how it goes when Game 17 is played. After a brief pause, we will talk about and present the highlights of an equally exciting Game 18 between the Disney All-Stars and the 80s All-Stars from Miami.
Shake your body, baby, do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer. Come on, shake your body, baby, do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer.
Welcome back. The latest chapter of the Battle of Florida took place last night in Miami as the Disney All-Stars faced the 80s All-Stars. Disney came into this game winless as they lost to Marvel Comics and Filmation, while the 80s All-Stars have dominated the defending champs Team Canada in Game 1 and destroyed Nickelodeon in Game 10, scoring a combined 96 points. In 2018, their most memorable game was the inaugural Disney Bowl, in which the 80s All-Stars won. In this chapter of this interstate rivalry, Disney got on the board first with a chip shot field goal, as it was the only score of the first quarter. In the second quarter, the 80s All-Stars came back in a big way as Jem threw an 86-yard touchdown pass to Chitara of the Thundercats to go up 7-3. Bumblebee added a field goal to go up 10-3. With over 3 minutes left, Buzz Lightyear ran the ball in from 2 yards out to tie the game at 10. Bumblebee's second field goal gave the 80s All-Stars a 13-10 lead with 19 seconds left in the first half. Just 15 seconds later, Mickey Mouse found Kim Possible to go ahead, but the point after attempt was blocked, for that hasn't happened in 3 years, as Disney led 16-13 at halftime. The only score of the third quarter occurred midway through the quarter, as April O'Neil of the Ninja Turtles rushed in from 14 yards out as the 80s All-Stars led 20-16. With under 3 minutes left to play, Mickey Mouse found Mabel Pines from Gravity Falls from 49 yards out to go up 23-20. With under a minute left, Jem saved the season for the 80s All-Stars as she ran into the end zone from 13 yards out to win 27-23. The 80s All-Stars go on to the quarterfinals, while Disney is eliminated from the tournament and finishes in 15th place. As for the stats in this game, beginning with Disney, Mickey Mouse finished 24 of 37 for 341 yards, 2 touchdowns, and 1 interception. He also rushed for 66 yards on 12 carries. Buzz Lightyear rushed for just 41 yards on 19 carries and 1 touchdown. Kim Possible led the receivers with 7 catches for 120 yards and 1 touchdown. Quasimodo from the Hunchback of Notre Dame led the defense with 8 tackles and 1 sack. Ariel finished with 5 points. For the 80s All-Stars, Jem, who was the player of the game for the second time this season, finished 18 of 30 for 223 yards, 1 touchdown, and 1 interception. She also rushed for 92 yards on 11 carries and the game-saving touchdown. April O'Neill rushed for 156 yards on 26 carries and 1 touchdown. Chitara led the receivers with 5 catches for 118 yards and 1 touchdown. Stormer from Jem led the defense with 7 tackles and 3 assists. Bumblebee finished with 7 points. And here is how the highlights of this exciting game looked on screen. I made a mistake. Mickey Mouse, not Buzz Lightyear, scored a touchdown in the second quarter. Otherwise, the stats are correct. If Mickey had about 5 seconds more to work with at the end of the game, he could have spiked the ball and had one more chance to win. But as you saw, Disney ran out of time. After a brief pause, we will continue our series of player profiles with a character who blazed a trail in toys, television, the movies, and the USCFL. We will profile Optimus Prime of the Transformers. Welcome back. The toy industry was very interesting in the 1980s. You had toys that were interactive, mind-blowing, that had sense, and a toy line that were two toys in one. The Transformers were the first convertible toys going from vehicles such as cars and planes to robots. Then, like most cartoon shows, they became a sensation on television. In more recent years, a series of explosive motion pictures. And one of these characters was so influential, WatchMojo called him the greatest animated character of the 1980s. For this week's player profile, we will profile the biography of Optimus Prime, a robot of great power, strength, and compassion towards his fellow robots and to humanity. And now for Optimus Prime's biography. Originally, Optimus Prime was created as the leader of the Autobots, though it is unknown how he was created or his origins. In a possible future, Megatron was threatened by the existence of the Aerial Bots and had Shockwave build a time machine to send them back in time to get rid of them. However, he only ended up changing history for the better. In the revised timeline, Optimus Prime began his life as a robot named Orion Pax, a mostly defenseless dock worker during the golden age of Cybertron 9 million years ago, with a girlfriend named Ariel and a best friend named Dion. During this time, a new breed of robot with new fight capabilities appeared on the planet, which the naive Orion and younger robots idolized. When Megatron, the leader of the new group of robots, approached him with inquiries about using one of the dock warehouses, Orion was swayed by Megatron. Orion, Ariel, and Dion were severely wounded when Megatron and his forces attacked in order to claim the energy stored there. Searching for someone to help them, the time-displaced Aerial Bots took Orion to the ancient Autobot Alpha Trion, who used him as the first subject of the new reconstruction process he had developed, involving rebuilding the frail Autobot frames into more battle-hardy configurations. With this reconstruction, Orion Pax became Optimus Prime, the first of the Autobot warriors. Optimus took the mantle of leadership as the Civil War against the Decepticons erupted and would remain in that position for the next 9 million years. As a leader of the Autobots, Prime headed up their mission to search for new sources of energy to revitalize the depleted Cybertron. Optimus vowed to Elita, that he would return from his mission for her. But just as before the launch of the Ark, Optimus was mistakenly led to believe that Alita was killed. Shortly after its launch, the Autobots craft was attacked by the Decepticons' space cruiser, the Nemesis, and boarded by Megatron and the Decepticons. In the ensuing struggle, the G-forces of a nearby planet pulled both crafts down and the Autobot ship crashed into a volcano, thrusting all the occupants into emergency stasis. 4 million years later, in the Earth year 1984, a volcanic eruption jarred the ship's computer, Teletran 1, back to life. The computer reactivated the Decepticons' programming, them with new Earth-based disguise modes. As a parting gesture, Starscream fired upon the Autobot ship, creating a landslide. The vibrations from that landslide knocked Prime into the path of the computer's restoration beam, restoring him to life, thus beginning the war anew on Earth. Over the course of the next 20 years, the Decepticons succeeded in seizing control of all of Cybertron, forcing the Autobots to operate from their new city on Earth and two bases on Cybertron's moons. In the Earth year 2005, Prime stationed on Moon Base 1 dispatched troops to Earth to acquire energy for an upcoming strike on Cybertron. The Decepticons, however, got wind of the plan and used the shuttle run to attack Autobot City. A distress call summoned Prime and support troops to Earth. In the fearsome ensuing battle with Megatron, Optimus Prime sustained fatal wounds, but not before turning the tide of the battle and forcing the Decepticons to flee. Despite the efforts of Perceptor, Optimus Prime went offline after passing the Matrix and the role of leader to Ultra Magnus. Despite prostrations, his last words were, "Until that day, till all are one." The Matrix fell later into the hands of Galvatron, a recreated Megatron, and was finally taken back by the young Autobot, Hot Rod. As the Matrix reformatted him, Hot Rod heard the voice of Optimus Prime saying, "Arise, Rodimus Prime. Instead of giving the Matrix back to Ultra Magnus, Rodimus decided to take the duty of leadership with Magnus as his second in command. Later, during one of those times when Rodimus was in command, a small group of Autobots and human allies, Spike and Daniel Witwicky, fled to the Autobot Mausoleum from the Decepticons. There they discovered that Optimus Prime was somehow resurrected. Rodimus then returns the Matrix to Optimus, reverting to his old self. However, Optimus does not act the same as before. He also appears to be mind-controlled, causing him to go insane and commit violent acts such as attempting to kill the group of Autobots and to trick the other Autobots on Cybertron to fly into a trap set by the Quintessence. As Hot Rod confronts him, Prime has a flashback of his resurrection at the hands of the Quintessence, who reprogrammed him in order to lead the Autobots into the trap. The influence of the Matrix eventually allows him to overcome the programming. He stopped attacking Hot Rod and returns the Matrix. Afterward, Optimus orders the Autobot fleet to move away from the trap. He pilots the Autobot flagship to the asteroid where the trap is set, triggering an explosion that seemingly kills him once again. The death of Optimus Prime in Transformers the movie received a strongly negative reaction from fans, so screenwriters decided to bring him back into the series in the subsequent season 3 finale, The Return of Optimus Prime. it was revealed that a group of humans had actually managed to retrieve his body prior to the destruction of the ship. But he was now contaminated by strange particles released in the explosion. Using Optimus' body to lure the Autobots, an anti-transformer scientist attempted to attack them with these particles, only to release a hate plague that turned all of those infected with it against others. With the plague spreading rapidly, Rodimus Prime ordered the Autobot Skylynx to rescue a Quintesson in the hope that it would be able to bring Optimus back to life to lead the remaining uninfected against the plague victims. After this plan was a success, Optimus was eventually able to reclaim the matrix of leadership from Rodimus Prime and learn that the plague could be countered with wisdom, prompting him to sacrifice the accumulated knowledge of the matrix to restore all those victims of the plague to normal. With the matrix now empty, Optimus mused that it would all be a little wiser now from the knowledge it had given them, and it was up to them all to refill it. While the Transformers animated series came to an end in America in 1987 after the Rebirth production was continued in Japan with three new exclusive animated series spin-offs to continue the story. The first of these series, Transformers the Headmasters, supplanted the events of the Rebirth. With the Decepticons defeated, the Autobots entered into an even closer relationship with Earth. The Autobots also began the colonization of other worlds, first of which was the planet Athena, where Optimus Prime was stationed. It soon became apparent, however, that the consequences of releasing energy of the Matrix to cure the hate plague was more far-reaching than Optimus had anticipated. Without the energy of the Matrix to act as a balancing factor, Vector Sigma had become destabilized. The Decepticons suddenly returned to exploit this, assaulting Cybertron in order to seize control of the mega computer. Prime took a squad of troops to aid in the battle on the planet. With the arrival of the Autobot Headmasters, tipped the battle in their favor, Prime broke off from the main attack and headed down into the depths of the planet, planning on stabilizing Vector Sigma at any cost. While the other Autobots searched for the Matrix on Earth, Optimus Prime searched for Vector Sigma, guided through the dangers of the planet's catacombs by the spirit of Alpha Trion. Prime eventually arrived at the computer only to find his way barred by Cyclonus and Scourge. At that moment, Hot Rod arrived with the Matrix, the same with which Alpha Trion merged, re-energizing it. The Matrix transformed Hot Rod back into Rodimus Prime, and for the first time, the two Primes fought side by side and defeated Galvatron. Before Rodimus could implement the Matrix to stabilize Vector Sigma, however, Optimus Prime merged himself with the computer, restoring its balance to save the planet. Optimus Prime sacrificed himself, dying again only for a few short episodes after his rebirth. Later, Prime would make a final and permanent return in the Japanese continuity, Battlestar's Return of Convoy. This entry was only available in print, appearing in the TV magazine, a Japanese publication. Optimus Prime, Bumblebee, and Spike Witwicky are the only main characters to appear in all of the seasons of the Transformers animated series and survive throughout the show. Optimus reappears in Generation 2 Redo, a BotCon magazine, which is set after the events of the final episode as a flashback where he led the first generation of Autobots to pursue Galvatron and Zarek in deep space. As for Optimus Prime's history in the USCFL, he and the rest of the Transformers joined the league in 1985 along with He-Man, and they became the first teams to use the now good guy, bad style of play, which is still in use today. This practice is where all the heroic and good characters plays on offense, while all the evil and villainous characters plays on defense. And even though that not all defensive players are evil or villainous, they do play on defense and are mixed with special teams. But in the USCFL, Optimus Prime is also a champion. As a player for the Transformers, he won 2 USCFL championships and was the most valuable player of Go for the Gold 47. After the Transformers were absorbed by the 80s All-Stars in 2015, he retired from the team and became a quarterback's coach. And quarterbacks and coaches Jem, Leonardo of the Ninja Turtles, and Lionel of the Thundercats to guide the 80s All-Stars to victory, which they did in 2018 in the inaugural Disney Bowl I had mentioned earlier. Optimus Prime is definitely more than meets the eye. On television, on the silver screen, in the toy lines, and now in the USCFL. The following video is a brand new video, which we feature Optimus Prime in his original Generation 1 form. And he will prove in this video that he has been and always will be King of the Road.
All right then, Autobots, transform. Roll for the show.
Trailer for sale or rent. Rooms to let 50 cents. No phone, no pool, no pets. Ain't got no cigarettes. Oh, but 2 hours of pushing broom buys a 8x12 4-bit room. I'm a man of means by no means. King of the road. Third boxcar, midnight train. Destination Bangor, Maine. Wool worn out suit and shoes. I don't pay no union dues. I smoke old stogies I have found. Short but not too big around. I'm a man of means by no means. King of the road. I know every engineer on every train, all of the children and all of their names, and every handout in every town, and every lock that ain't locked when no one's around. I sing trailers for sale or rent, rooms to let 50 cents. No phone, no pool, no pets. Ain't got no cigarettes, but 2 hours of pushing broom buys a 8x12 4-bit room. I'm a man of means by no means. King of the road. Trailers for sale rent. Rooms to let 50 cents. No phone, no pool, no pets. Ain't got no cigarettes, but 2 hours of pushing broom buys.
Yeah, but there is only one great leader in the universe. Have a seat, boss.
Thrones are for Decepticons. Besides, I'd rather roll.
After one final pause, we will reveal the answer to last week's trivia question, this week's question, and a preview of next week's games. Welcome back. Now for the answer to last week's trivia question. We asked in the episode Krusty Love, and after Mr. Krabs was introduced to Mrs. Puff, he took her for an expensive dinner in an expensive restaurant. How much money did Mr. Krabs spend on this date? If you guessed $100,000, you are right. I guess even Mr. Krabs isn't immune to the power of love. Now for this week's question. This week's question is a true or false question. Remember, true or false questions have no degree of difficulty, for you have a 50-50 chance of being correct. Also, if participating in our trivia challenge, please do not put your answers in the comments section. Put your answers down on paper and check back each week for the correct answer. Putting your answers in the comments section might accidentally give away the correct answer. With that, here is this week's question. True or false? Former President Richard Nixon's famous "I'm not a crook" speech was made at Disneyland. We'll have the answer for you next week. And that's it for week 9 and the start of round 3 of the USCFL's 2022 season. Next week, we'll return to both Kansas City and Richmond, Virginia, as we present the highlights of Game 19 between the Sci-Fi All-Stars and the DC Comics All-Stars from Kansas City, and the highlights of Game 20 between the Nickelodeon All-Stars and the Filmation All-Stars from Richmond, Virginia. Which two teams will be eliminated next? Find out next week, along with another USCFL player profile. And until next Sunday, this is Robbie Graham of the USCFL Network wishing you peace. Take care and stay safe.
And franchises mentioned throughout this webcast remains the copyrights of their respective owners. They were used for the purpose of entertainment and or education, and therefore no breach of any copyright laws were intended. This webcast is protected under copyright and must not be rewritten, re-recorded, rebroadcast, or re-uploaded in whole or in part without the prior written consent of First and Ten Productions, the American Association of Animation, and the United States Cartoon Football League. Copyright 2022.